GreensideDawah.com/donate.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اعلموا عباد الله أن أحسن الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد عباد الله My dear brothers and sisters, I would like first and foremost to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings that Allah has bestowed upon us in this community. I would like to thank the second thing to thank this community for its wonderful support over the past years, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, in being together, united, one hand, alhamdulillah, for the good cause of making the best for this community, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, for the Muslims all over, bidnillahi azza wa jal. The good news is, alhamdulillah, starting today, or officially today, actually, just a few hours ago, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, this facility that you are now praying Salatul Jum'ah is officially a waqf, bidnillahi azza wa jal. The purchase deal has been actually, alhamdulillah, going through. We signed the contracts today before the Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. So from now, this actually belongs to the Muslim community of the Valorant. So alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. And say alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow upon us that which is best, ya Allah, in this dunya and the akhirah. Of course, as you guys all know, it's just the beginning. Because when it comes to a community and building a community, it's not really about a building. It's all about building what is beyond just the walls of this masjid and this musalla. This is just the start. And we're very happy and very pleased, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, to call this, again, for us at least, the temporary home of Valley Ranch community, inshallah ta'ala, until we're done from our official masjid and project, bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. But still, it is a waqf right now, inshallah. It is a running charity. And hopefully, bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala, for every dollar that we spend on this building, it will go towards your running charity, inshallah, azza wa jalla. It will go through your waqf, bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala, donations, and you will enjoy the reward of this investment, inshallah ta'ala, in the dunya and in the akhirah, long after we are gone from this world. The importance of waqf, ya ikhwan, I would like to talk to you in this khutbah about the importance of waqf, the importance of endowment when we purchase assets. In a Muslim community, specifically as we live in a society that doesn't support these masajid voluntarily, it has to be done from the Muslim community itself. How can we ensure? How can we ensure in time as difficult as ours right now, when there is a huge even debate over the identity of this country and this society? America is going through identity crisis. Everything is now under question, whether it's a matter of race, color, ethnicity, culture, or even religion, which is on which the base of this country was actually established, freedom of religion, right? But now even this is being threatened by this administration. And Allah knows what actually the future is hiding for us and for the people all around. But one fundamental thing we learn from the history of the Muslim Ummah and the world altogether, Muslims and non-Muslim, that awqaf, an endowment, meaning investing by purchasing assets in order to ensure the continuation of a certain tradition or culture, actually it has always been throughout the history of Islam. And I want to share with you a few things, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala, about this concept of awqaf. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi, he recommended people they participate and invest in building masajid. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من بنى لله مسجدا ولو كمفحص قطا بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. Whoever builds a house, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this dunya, which means if you build a masjid, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he compared it so small, even if it was a مفحص قطا, مفحص قطا, which means just a bird's nest. I mean, how big is a bird's nest anyway? The biggest nest, how big is it going to be anyway? How many people can fit in there? But that's a metaphoric expression, of course. Like the Prophet ﷺ says, it doesn't matter the size. What matters is the purpose. What is it going to serve? And who is going to be actually enjoying, you know, being there and enjoying the ibadah over there, subhanAllah. And that is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Bana Allahu lahu baytan fil Jannah, a house in Al Jannah will be secured for this person who participate in building these houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and participating in this. And alhamdulillah, we're very proud that the Muslim community in the Dallas area is increasing before Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Many, many people are moving into this area. The need to have easy access to these masajid and musallayat is also increasing as well. The other day, which is ironic, subhanAllah, the other day I was given a presentation in the Methodist church here in Kapel. And it was around Maghrib time. So by the time it was done, Maghrib was coming in. And I was kind of getting worried if I'm going to catch Salatul Maghrib, you know, because it was all close to rush hours, as people coming, you know, it's going to traffic jam. If I'm going to drive all the way to Valley Ranch Masjid, I might miss it. And then I remembered, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, we have another actually Musalla that was open also in Kapel. The Kapel was Bil Musalla. I said, Alhamdulillah, I drove there 2 minutes. I was just right there, prayed Maghrib on time, feeling the blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that blessing will continue, inshallah, as much and as long as we keep supporting these beautiful projects and these beautiful, beautiful institutions. In order to ensure the tradition and the culture of any nation, it has to be secured through the system of what we call it in Islam, awqaf. This is what we call it, waqf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Those who truly يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ, which means establish, the establishment not necessarily in terms of just the actual physical foundation of it. It also means the foundation from the inside, the foundation of a community. Those who truly believe in Allah and the hereafter. So when you give to projects like these, it's a testimony of faith. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. It's a testimony of faith that when you do so, you truly believe in that. Because honestly, what investment, what is the return that you're getting out of putting your money in projects like these? In terms of dunya, probably not much in terms of financial investment. But in terms of the akhirah and the dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's a testimony of faith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that He will return back, if not in the dunya, it will be in the akhirah. You see, when it comes to building these institutions, once again, we don't have the option of having, you know, federal fund for this. It's not like with some Muslim countries and even some European countries where institutions like these are actually funded by the state. We don't have that luxury over here. So this goes back again to the Muslim community and the challenge on how far are they willing to support their institutions to ensure the continuation of their tradition and their culture and their existence as an independent community. How far are they willing to do that? And that's where we come with this project, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Like we said, in order for us to ensure this, we need to secure this building and this facility, especially that Ramadan is coming very soon, inshallah. We would like to have the best experience for all of you here, bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. They even say, if you read, even historically speaking, nations, Muslims and non-Muslims, when they stopped investing in endowments and awqaf, the culture started, you know, fading out slowly and gradually. Erosion started taking it from the inside out until it was over. But when you have awqaf, you realize the continuation of the tradition and the culture. And obviously, if we didn't know Islamic history, there is no doubt. It's a great testimony. Everywhere you go in the Muslim world, everywhere you go, not even the Muslim world, any area that Muslims ever existed, whether it's in Europe or in Africa, you will find some spaces there. You call them awqaf. And these awqaf go all the way back to the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith, the establishment of awqaf began at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa, one of the famous hadith, very popular hadith in the interpretation, tafsir of ayat Surah Al-Imran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. That you're not going to achieve, you're not going to have al-birr. What is al-birr? We explained that in one of our tafsir sessions over here. Al-birr comes, subhanAllah, from the spacious nature of being good. Like goodness, piety, righteousness, you name it. However that is, there has no boundaries, no limit. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that essence of goodness, that essence of piety and righteousness, you are unable to achieve it, حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَا تُحِبُّونَ, until you give from the possessions that you love the most. And that's what Allah says, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ, whoever is protected and guarded against the stinginess of the self and soul. فَأُولَٰئِكُمْ مُفْلِحُونَ, those are the most successful. SubhanAllah, when you give what you've earned fair and square, your money, your wealth, and when you give it away for no reason, Other than hoping for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once again, it's one of the greatest testimonies of faith. So Allah says that true meaning of piety and righteousness, you won't be able to achieve it until you give freely and you give genuinely from that which you love the most. Abu Talha, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon hearing this revelation, this ayah, he was excited. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and says, Ya Rasulullah, inna ahabba mali ladayya wa indi bayruha, that the most beloved asset that I have and I own is bayruha, which is a garden that I own. It's like an orchard that has palm trees and fruit and water fountains, and like an amazing, you could say garden that you, it's the best thing you have. So this is the most beloved to me, the most precious of all my possession that I own, Ya Rasulullah. He said, and I would like you to be my witness that I'm giving this fi sabilillah as sadaqah. That's it. It's my most beloved money. And I want to give it fi sabilillah as sadaqah. The Prophet says, bakh. Like, mashallah. Rabih al-bay. Like, what a lucrative bargain you're making right now. But then he suggested something to him. He says, how about you keep it within your own family? Which means distribute that and make this to be waqf for your own family. So Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala an, he kept that waqf and he made the profit that comes out of it, whatever that the harvest that comes out of it, to be distributed and given to his relatives and his family members, those who are needy in the family. But subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he encouraged Abu Talha radiallahu an. And once again, Abu Talha, he heard the ayah and immediately he went to the best of what he owns and said, Ya Rasulullah, this is it. I love it so much to the extent I'm willing to give it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. He knew that the Muslim community in Medina, at some point there is so much need for water. There was drought. They need so much. Badly they need that water. And because of the supplies were kind of becoming so scarce, looking around, there was one water well owned by a Jewish man in the area, known as Bi'r Ruma. That water well was called Bi'r Ruma, the water well of Ruma. So he went to him and he negotiated the price with him. Finally, he was able to make a good deal. Can you imagine buying a water well during times of drought? Can you imagine how much money you're going to be paying just to get that, secure that position of this? So he paid a fortune, radiallahu ta'ala. He paid a fortune. Then he took the position of that water well. Then what he did with it? He made it fi sabilillah. Instead of, you know, charging the people like the man before him used to do, he said, that's it. I give it fi sabilillah and let the Muslims enjoy it. And subhanAllah, until this day, this actually, it goes back again to the reward goes back again to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. And these are the kind of examples we see from the awqaf that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they participated and they helped establish. When the ulama speak about awqaf, they say al-waqf is an asset that you keep, that you donate the possession of it or the ownership of it. Fi sabilillah. So it stays like public domain right now. And the outcome, which we call the ray' in the Arabic language, a ray', whatever comes out, is given for a particular cause that you're giving the donation for. And that's why the awqaf in the history of Islam were many. There are many, many different awqaf. Some of them are called awqafun ray'iyah, which means investment awqaf, meaning that it actually produces wealth and money and income. And that income is given to that particular cause that you have made your waqf for, whether it's Islamic center, masjid, or school, or tahfid Quran, or aitam, whatever that is, it's given there. And some of the awqaf are not ray'i. In some of the awqaf, some of these actual awqaf, the asset, it doesn't bring any income. Like, for example, the masajid. You have a land, you have a space there, so you give this as a waqf. I don't want the land, I want fi sabilillah. There is no money coming out of it. But there is so much khair will come out of it. The same thing, a building like this. You buy it and you just say, you know what? There's no income might come out of it at all. But there is so much khair will come out of it. So much blessing and ni'am will come out of it. People come and pray. People come and learn. Children memorize the Quran. You produce huffad over here. Alhamdulillah, just last weekend we celebrated the graduation of four huffad, four hafidat from this masjid. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Ameen. Four new kids, alhamdulillah, just finished their Quran before the Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the series continue, and we will inshallah produce more bin Allah azza wa jal. You come over here, people, they come and take, and alhamdulillah, attend this session, these lessons, and they will tell you and they appreciate how much they're learning from this. Just last weekend, we had a parenting workshop over here. And we had, alhamdulillah, over 50 plus parents, couples, come over here to attend the program. And when they left, they were so happy, they're so excited. Some of them, they stood out with me and they talked to me, said, subhanAllah, this is amazing. This is amazing. And it was so exciting that they said, next time when we come, we're going to bring more people from different areas and from the metroplex over here. And wallahi, that same program over here, which we have, would happen to be here in our masjid, in our classroom. I received text messages online on social media, people from other communities, they would like to have conference call with me to teach them and educate them and coach them on how to kind of duplicate that program for their community, their masajid in different places in America. Other communities for out of state. Where all of this is coming from? The khair is coming from here. And I guarantee you, whatever investment that we put in this, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, we will all share the reward. Wallahi, we will all share the reward. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he promised that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will secure that reward for you. And I guarantee on behalf of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for every penny spent in this bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give back to you, ya Rabbil Alameen. SubhanAllah, when it comes to show some of the examples of the awqaf, the Muslim ummah used to have back in those days. Some of these awqaf are unbelievable, amazing. And historically, you know, even subhanAllah, just historically, even in our modern day. I was reading a book on volunteering and the concept and the principle of volunteering in communities and societies. One of the things the authors, they agree on that when it comes to volunteering, which means when it comes to giving your time, giving your money, and giving your effort, that's a sign of a healthy community. When the community is healthy, giving money, and giving time and giving effort, it's a sign of a strong and healthy community. People might not be rich to give, but they will still generously give from what they have. Why? Because again, it's about the community. It's not just about how much money you have. People might have only $2. But wallahi, they're willing to give $1. That's 50% of what they have. That's a lot of money. A lot of money for someone who has only $2. But it's not about giving the money as much as where it's coming from the heart. And subhanAllah, the Muslim ummah had amazing principles, amazing examples of awqaf. Where did the awqaf, the money, go? Whenever they collected that money, where would it go? And what kind of awqaf people established? Here's some examples that I read in books of history and books of fiqh. Some awqaf, we're all about water. The most important thing, the source of life. So you will see people along the way of a certain trade route, for example, or Hajj journey, or the Umrah, whoever there is. Some people, their job is just to make sure that they sponsor somebody to dig a water well somewhere along the way to Hajj or Umrah to secure the people's water actually there. Some of them were rich people, like the mother of the Khulafa of Bani al-Abbas. The mother of the Khulafa Bayan al-Abbas, she even established an entire water line to supply this to the Hujjaj as they come actually along the way for Hajj or Umrah in the middle of the desert. Can you imagine how many people they benefited from that water well and that water fountain that she established there along the way throughout the time until subhanAllah alam what happened to it. But the point is, water is the source of life. And I live in some Muslim country, I live in Kuwait actually for some time, and I've seen that. A lot of people, because you live in the Middle East and in the Arabian Peninsula, it's very hot during the summer. A lot of houses I've seen, what do? They purchase a water, mashallah, fountain, a water actually machine, that's they keep it outside of their house, and it's linked to the water source of their own homes. And it's attached, of course, it's been plugged into the electricity, so you always, as you pass by, you always have, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, fresh, clean, cold water in the summer, all the time. You don't have electricity, it doesn't matter. Sometimes they use these, what they call these pottery, you know, containers. And you just drink from it. All of this is part of their goodness, part of, you know, thinking about other people and giving for this fi sabilillah. That's a form of awqaf. Whatever that container is, even though it might not be that expensive, but it's another waqf that was established at that time. People, they used to establish awqaf as homes. Homes for whom? For Ibn al-Sabil, travelers. Those who come into middle, back in then, they didn't have hotels like we do have them today. It was a luxury. So they spend their time in Masajid, or even just they cannot knock on doors, say, could you please, you know, give us hospitality for 1 or 2 days, and we're on their way. That's why Ibn al-Sabil is one of the great principles of giving fi sabilillah, giving the charity to actually. So people, they used to establish houses and homes and these kind of shelters for the people as they move around actually. And that was amazing thing, subhanAllah, for them. Another thing that they have done, schools. And if you read the history of fiqh, there are a lot of schools dedicated to certain particular madhab. Like for Maslak, you could say, for example, the Shafi'is, the Hanafis, the Hanbalis, and so on. A lot of examples for this. Another example, they used to make actually houses dedicated to seniors. Like we have here in America, but it's not for free. Back then, they used to have senior homes, and they were awqaf. Some elders, they lose their families. They lose their children. Or maybe they travel somewhere else, and they're completely cut off from the society. The community takes care of them through awqaf. Even from the interesting things about awqaf that I read, subhanAllah, there was an awqaf for animals. Can you imagine? Animal shelters. It's not a new concept, the Jama'ah. You read in books of fiqh, the Muslim community, the Muslim ummah, provided animal shelters. Stray animals sometimes, they get them actually there. Horses, specifically, they used to dedicate these animals, actually these shelters, for the animals that were in the service of the state. You want to have camels, horses, whatever that they used back then. When it reaches certain age, it's unable to carry the load or even to be, you know, to function very well. They just throw it away in the streets. No, they take them to the animal shelter where they graze in an open pasture and they keep enjoying it until they die. Subhanallah. What an amazing principle of just even caring about these animals. And another thing, they even had shelters for women, battered women, subhanallah, like we have here in America. And they had it back then. Used to call them, they have certain names for them. But if a woman, for example, she's having trouble with her husband or her spouse, and she has nowhere to go, will be taking care in that shelter until situation resolved for her. They had that as awqaf as well. But one of the most interesting awqaf I read about, which is something, you know, it was just like amazing, like wow. They thought about these awqaf even to that level. They call it a waqful fakhar. Waqful fakhar, which means the waqf of the of pottery, you know, clay. What is that? Basically, some of these artisans, what they do, they have certain shelves, and they have plates, they have pots, they have whatever containers they made from clay back in the day, and they store them and they keep them on these shelves. And this is considered awqaf, for free. Why did they get that for? Because they knew that some kids, some servants, they will be carrying these plates or these pots, and they leave the house. And as they walk to go and buy something and put it in that thing until they come back home, kids are kids, young ones are young ones, they might trip, they might be distracted, it falls, it breaks. Going home with a broken plate might cause them to be punished. SubhanAllah, so how they thought about them? They made waqful fakhar. This is for free. If you break your plate, don't worry, don't tell your mom. Go and pick up one for free and go home with that. So you don't have to deal with that, subhanAllah. It is to that level the community has been, subhanAllah, dedicated, thinking so highly of taking care of each other, taking care of the elders, the men, the women, the educated, the ulama, the atfal, the orphans, subhanAllah, even the animals, dedicated time and awqaf for all of that. Why? It's because of this system that the entire Muslim community flourished and the society flourished, subhanAllah, until we today are enjoying and we are reaping, alhamdulillah, the benefit of this legacy. It is time for us right now to carry that legacy and moving it to the next phase, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. The opportunity is opened for those who would like to participate. It is open, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again bless this community with the khayr rabbil alameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa lisa al-muslimin wa astaghfiru innahu al-ghafur rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira thumma amma ba'd ibadallah, my dear brothers and sisters, once again, we'd like to congratulate the community, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, for this a new step, inshallah ta'ala, ahead for our community. that we officially, once again, we purchased this building, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And this is from now is considered a waqf for you, for all the community, for the Allahi Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make every penny that you spend on this building to go into your running charity, Ya Rabbil Alameen. That long after we've gone from this world, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to write our reward for everything that will be coming out, everything khair that is coming out of this building and out of this facility, inshaAllah wa tabaraka wa ta'ala. It is a golden opportunity, Ya Ikhwa. This is not an official fundraising, wallahi. But it's just so, I'm so excited, so happy, alhamdulillah, that we reach at this milestone our community for the Allahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. And I would like to invite myself and each and every one of you to take advantage of this opportunity right now. And if you put your money today, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, be among the pioneers and the first people to add to it, inshallah, until we make it complete, bin Allahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. Take the opportunity and give generously, barakallahu feekum. Allahumma alimna ma anfa'na. وانفعنا بما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها مولاها عباد الله إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأقم الصلاة